We've been talking a lot about how the book of James is rather hard-hitting, it hits you where I think we need to be. There's a lot of books in the Bible that are very doctrinally oriented, particularly in the New Testament. There's areas like in Romans and elsewhere where the scriptures have a lot to say about particular doctrinal issues and so forth, and those are all good and they're all appropriate and they're all useful, but that's not really James's aim. He really wants to talk to us about Christianity in the practical arena, how you and I live out our walk with the Lord. And in the first chapter, he talked about how a mature believer is going to look at things like trials and difficulties and challenges and so forth. In the second chapter, we dealt with some other issues related to the fruit of our lives bearing itself out as a testimony of who we are in Christ and why and how faith and deeds do go together and so forth. Now, as we get into the third chapter, James is going to meddle even more in our lives. And he's going to talk to us about the words that come out of our mouth. And I know that there's not one person in this room who has a perfect score on this issue. We've all said things we shouldn't have said. We've been careless. We've been reckless. We've been cruel at times. And many of us who lived a number of years outside of knowing and walking with Jesus took on a likeness to the ways of the world in terms of how we spoke, the way we used our tongue. I've shared with you guys before that, I really started walking serious with the Lord when I was in my early 20s. I kind of came to the Lord, I think, when I was in my teen years. I'll have to ask the Lord when I'm with him. But it's like, just exactly when did you put that name down in the book, sort of a thing. But anyway, I started really walking with the Lord at probably around age 20, I don't know, 3 or something like that, 4. And one of the most disappointing things about my early Christian walk was that I kept opening my mouth and saying all kinds of vulgar and obscene things. I had given such freedom to my tongue, before I was walking with the Lord and it particularly came out when I was angry, but not necessarily. Sometimes I was just being stupid, but I would say all kinds of obscene and vulgar things. I mean, I had a real potty mouth, as they say. And that was all fine and good, I suppose, while I was walking in the world and didn't really care a thing about God or going to church or living for the Lord. But when I came to Christ, I found out that I'd get angry and I would still spew this horrible stuff. And sometimes I would literally cry out to God and say, "What is going on? I thought that when you walk with Jesus, there's supposed to be some changes in your life. I thought that there's supposed to be something new." And I was kind of expecting, I was going to be a different person from the standpoint of my speech and so forth. It took years for the Lord to really kind of do a work in my life to the point where my speech began to show the change that took place in my heart the day I met Jesus and really walked with him. And sometimes that's the case, isn't it? Sometimes it just takes time. There are things in our lives that die hard. And that doesn't give us an excuse to keep doing them. It just simply explains sometimes why we do keep doing them. But the tongue is a particularly challenging little instrument in our lives to control. In fact, as James is about to tell us here, it really lies beyond our ability. But he begins actually this chapter with a word not to just the general populace per se, but specifically to teachers of the word. Here's what he says. It's rendered in the NIV this way: "Not many of you should presume to be teachers, my brothers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly." And so he says to us that for those who teach the word of God, there is a stricter, a more strict judgment that will come upon those because of the fact that they are conveying to people what God's word says. And it's a real slippery slope. I got to tell you, there's been a lot of mornings, early mornings about 2 a.m. where I've laid awake in bed and shook. Usually it's on like a Monday morning around 2, wondering, thinking, you know, going back through my mind at everything that I said when I taught the Word of God the day before, and wondering just how much I got wrong, you know, and what God was going to do about it. But I think this verse is particularly insightful if you look at it in the J.B. Phillips translation, which I'll put up on the screen for you. He says, "Don't aim at adding to the number of teachers, my brothers, I beg you. Remember that we who are teachers will be judged by a much higher standard." And what, you know, what that's all about is basically twofold. There's kind of a twofold reason why I think teachers are going to be judged by a higher standard, and I've already alluded to the first one. And the first is because we're basically what God is like. We're conveying to people the heart of the Lord, and He takes that pretty seriously, actually. Do you remember the story of Moses in the wilderness with the nation of Israel? And early on in their travels through the wilderness, the people were thirsty and there was no water. And they were, you know, complaining and groaning and moaning. And God spoke to Moses and He said, "Take your staff and go out and stand by this big huge rock out there, and take your staff and strike the rock, and I will cause water to come out of the rock, and not just a trickle either. It will gush out to the point where all the people and all the animals will have plenty of water to drink." And when you figure it was probably somewhere like 2.5 million people in the wilderness, that's a lot of water. So don't think of it as a trickle. Well, about 38 years later, they made this big loop and it happened again, and the people once again came back to the same place. Once again there was no water to drink, and once again the people were moaning, groaning, and complaining and grumbling against Moses. You know, this is Moses and Aaron talking, and then, you know, they haven't learned a thing. And Moses has had it about up to here with these people. You ever been there? And they fall on their face before God, and the Lord, and they, meaning Aaron and Moses, and the Lord speaks to Moses, and He says, "Moses, go before the people, stand by the rock, and speak to the rock, and I will bring water from it to take care of the people." The only problem is Moses got up off his face, and he was mad. He was mad that the people were complaining. He was mad because the people hadn't seemed to learn anything in 38 to 40 years. He was mad that they were grumbling and complaining and pointing the finger at him. And he was mad that there was talk about, you know, this and that, and we ought to go back to Egypt. It was better there. And, you know, God doesn't need it. And he was mad. And so rather than speaking to the rock, Moses got up in front of the people and he kind of bit at them. "When are you people going to learn?" And he grabs his staff and he strikes the rock twice. He's angry. And God, by grace and mercy, causes water to come out of the rock, and it takes care of all the people and so forth. But because of that one single event, Moses wasn't able to go into the promised land himself. Because of that one single event, God said to Moses, "You're not going in, buddy. You can see the promised land from a hill, but I'm not letting you go in. Because you disobeyed me." But see, the disobedience wasn't just this idea where I told you to speak, you struck. It was, you didn't represent me. "Moses, I wasn't mad. You were mad. I love these guys. I love to bless them. I know they're a stiff-necked people. I know that. I know they're always going astray. But I love them, and I long to show mercy. I delight to show grace. I love these people. You were angry, Moses. I wasn't." And so, you know, we see from that story that, you know, God takes it pretty seriously, how we represent the Lord. And if I'm conveying something to you of the heart of the Lord that just isn't in keeping with His heart, then there is a stricter judgment for me, because I have presumed to basically share the heart of the Lord in that respect. There's another reason, though, why teachers are going to be judged more strictly than others. And frankly, it's because teachers usually know more of the Word of God because they spend more time studying it. They're in it all the time. Do you remember when Jesus was walking the earth? Some of the people He had the strongest words for were the teachers of the law. The scribes, who sat with the Word of God day in and day out in front of them, taught that Word, studied that Word, meditated on that Word, and still came up with these cockamamie ideas about what it meant to serve God and love God and all these things to weasel their way around the commands of God and so forth. And, well, you really don't have to do this, you know, in obedience to the Word of God if you do this over here. And you know, and Jesus was constantly confronting them about that. Why? Because the more you know of the Word of God, the greater your responsibility is to follow it. I don't know if you're aware of that or not, but just by coming to church and hearing the Word of God, your level of responsibility goes boop. And then you come back and you hear a little more, and your responsibility goes boop. And every time you hear more of the Word of God, your level of responsibility goes up. Because with knowledge and insight comes greater responsibility. You and I can't look at God and go, no one ever told me about that. God says, yeah, I told you. I told you. I made it very plain in my Word. And you were right there, Bible open, on your lap, nodding your head in agreement. You knew. See, there's more responsibility that comes with more understanding. And a teacher is probably likely to do that. You know, when we study through the Word of God, when I study through the Word of God to teach the Word of God, I do a lot more. I learn a lot more in my study than I actually convey to you on a Sunday or a Wednesday. You know, I listen to other pastors. I read, you know, the passage through in several different translations or whatever I may do for that particular week, and I gain more than I actually bring out. Well, guess what? That makes me more responsible to follow it. You know, can't plead ignorance. You know what I mean? All right, so he goes on then in verses 2 and following to deal with this whole issue of the tongue and the danger of the tongue. But before we read these verses, give me your attention for a minute. I was hearing about another pastor who had a very creative way of dealing with this. I wish I had a thought of it. I really do. It would have been really cool. But there was a pastor who's now with the Lord who finished his study up on a Sunday, and he said to the people of the church that he was pastoring, he said, next Sunday when we come together, I'm going to reveal to you the biggest troublemaker in the church. And then he closed and left. and everybody's like... And you kind of wonder if they'd like not want to come back to church the next week, just in case, you know, somebody might point the finger at them. But that wasn't what happened. They all came back to church the next Sunday. They all wanted to know. In fact, he says the whole town came to church on Sunday. They all heard pastor's going to reveal the biggest troublemaker in the church. So they're all sitting on the edge of their chairs, you know, waiting with bated bad breath. And the pastor opens up James chapter 3, starts talking about the tongue, the number one troublemaker in the church. Verse 2, look with me there. He says, we all stumble in many ways. If anyone is never at fault in what he says, he's a perfect man, able to keep his whole body in check. James is stating a fact here. We all stumble in many ways. That's not an excuse. That doesn't give you and I an excuse to say things that are dumb or that are hurtful or cruel. He's just stating a fact. And he says, if you were to find someone who was never at fault in the usage of his tongue, you would then find a perfect man. You'd find a perfect man. Why? Because what comes out of our mouth originates in the heart, right? Remember that passage says, out of the overflow or the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Okay? So where do those words come from? They come from the heart. There's no denying it. We like to try to deny it, but the Word doesn't let us. So if you could find someone who never erred related to what they say out of their mouth, you would find a perfect man, because that would show a perfect heart. James says basically it ain't going to happen. But he goes on to talk about the power of the tongue. Now in these next couple of verses, verses 3 and 4, he talks about how small things can have a big impact on larger things, and the first two things are even kind of positive. He starts off by saying, when we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. And you know, relatively speaking, that bit that you put into the mouth of the horse is a fairly small piece of equipment relative to the whole size of the horse. And I'll never forget when I was about 11 years old, I had a lesson in how big these horses really are when one of them came over and stood on my foot and didn't get off. Wouldn't leave, you know. And finally, you know, we smacked him hard enough that he kept walking. And man, I tell you, it's like you just get a sense of that is a big animal. And here's this little bit that controls the animal. But see, that's a good thing. That's a good thing where a small thing controls a bigger thing. He gives another example in verse 4 by saying, or take ships as an example. And obviously they're bigger today than they were in his day. But he says, although they are so large, they're driven by strong winds and they're steered by a very small rudder, relatively speaking, wherever the pilot wants them to go. Once again, that's a good thing. It's a good thing that you can put a rudder on a ship and that although being a fairly small piece of equipment, it can steer the entire vessel. That's a good thing. Okay? But now we begin to look at the negative side of these examples of a small thing making a big impact. And he says, likewise, in other words, in the same way, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts, you know, big talk. And then he says, consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. Some of you guys here, or even gals, have worked like, you know, with fire, forestation, firefighting sort of stuff, and maybe you've been around a big blaze. I can't think of a time that I have, but boy, you know, you see those things on the news, and thousands of acres of some like California forest is up in flames, and then they do this investigation, and they find out it was a 10-year-old kid with a $1.49 Bic lighter, you know, that started the whole thing. And he's out there, you know, playing with his lighter, and suddenly, you know, you got thousands and thousands of acres that are torched. And it's amazing to think that, you know, just with this single flame, this little flame, that this enormous fire, you know, can result. But that's the point of what James is saying here, and he's relating it to the tongue, you guys. He's saying basically this tongue that is in your head is pretty small in comparison with the other things or the other members or parts of your body. But man alive, can it start fires. And that's why he says in verse 6, and this is a good verse, the tongue also is a fire. And that's a negative side. That's the negative side of the equation. The tongue is also a fire. In fact, he calls it a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person, sets the whole course of his life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell. You know, I wouldn't have had a clue what he meant by that last statement about the tongue being set on fire by the fires of hell if Jesus hadn't told us this simple parable, which is only recorded in one of the gospel accounts. It's recorded in Luke. If you're taking notes, we won't take time to turn there, but it's in Luke 16. Jesus tells this parable, actually a story, of this diseased beggar named Lazarus who lays at the doorstep of a rich man begging for food. Eventually, the beggar dies and is taken to a place of comfort. Heaven basically has not been opened yet because Christ has not yet died on the cross and opened the way. So he's taken to this place of comfort. The rich man finally dies and is taken to a place of torment, awaiting final judgment. What's interesting about this is that Jesus said that these two, for lack of a better word, compartments, can see one another. There's a chasm fixed between them, so people can't pass between them, but they can see one another. And the man, the rich man, who is in torment, in the flames, calls over to Abraham, sees Father Abraham in the distance and says, Abraham, send Lazarus over here to give me some comfort. Only, he says, and here's what he said. Here's what he said. Even if he takes his finger and dips it in a glass of water and to cool my tongue. Isn't that interesting? And then he goes on to say, for I am in agony in these flames. The tongue, and that lines up exactly with what James says here. The tongue is not only a world of evil and a deadly fire, it is itself set on fire. kind of gives some new perspective about the things we say, doesn't it? And the power that we have to say them and so forth. But he goes on in verses 7 and 8 to say that all kinds of animals, birds, even reptiles and creatures of the sea have been tamed and have been tamed by man. But no man can tame the tongue. No man can tame the tongue. It's not possible. So don't even try. You can't tame your tongue. You know why? I already told you. Because it's connected to the heart. And you and I can't change our hearts. Only God can change the heart. Right? Now, so you got some bad news there and you got some good news. The bad news is you can't change your heart. The good news is God can and will as we present it. And you see, that was the thing that made such stress and frustration for me when I was a brand new believer, because God was in the process of changing my heart, but I was still so caught in the habitual act of vulgar, obscene language that when I got angry, it just came spewing out. And the thing that frustrated me more than anything is that I couldn't stop it. I couldn't stop it. I was captive. But God set me free as I cried out to Him. And as I gave Him that permission to change my heart and just stayed in the Word and just kept trucking with the Lord, you know, eventually those things straightened themselves out in the power of God's grace. But sometimes it takes time. I hope that for those of you that may struggle with words that come out of your mouth, I hope that's an encouragement to you today. I got to tell you, I had a little older gal in our fellowship this morning after first service. Boy, she made a beeline for me up here after first service and just said, "I am so glad to hear you say that." She's a fairly new believer. She said, "I have struggled. I had years and years and years and years of obscene language. And now I've met the Lord and I've just been so frustrated with myself because those things still crop up. And I just was able to say, 'Sister, I understand. Just keep going. Keep walking with Jesus. Keep allowing the Word of God to wash your heart and mind, and repent of those things when they happen and ask God to give you the strength, and He will.'" The last part of verse 8 says that the tongue is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. You know, we just finished going through the book of Proverbs on Wednesday night before we broke for August. But if you made a mark in your Bible, just in the book of Proverbs alone, next to every verse that talked about speech, language, the words that come out of your mouth and so forth, you would mark up your Bible a lot. And there's one particular verse I wanted to show you here from Proverbs chapter 10. It says, "When words are many, sin is not absent, but he who holds his tongue is wise." I'll paraphrase that. When people talk a lot, sin's right there. It's better to hold your tongue than to talk a lot. And that's one of the reasons that I tell married couples, particularly, if you're having an issue with another and the emotions are right up there, take a time out. Go to your corners, cool down. Do not talk to your spouse when you're angry, because you'll never say anything good. And you're more than likely to say something really stupid that could take you years, literally, to get over. When James says that the tongue is a restless evil, and it's full of deadly poison, he's not kidding. That's not just poetic language to kind of sound cool. It means it's deadly. It means that it can kill. Language can kill. It can kill a child's innocence. It can kill a marriage relationship. I've seen it happen many times. Reckless, cruel, stupid words. A couple needs to come together in their marriage relationship and make an agreement. I mean, literally make an agreement, eye to eye, just like this. If we're dealing with something and the emotions are running high, we agree to keep our mouths shut and wait until we're cool to talk about it. And if when we start to talk about it, the emotions rise again, we're going to stop again. Why? Because we don't want to put up with any of that deadly poison in our relationship, and that's what's going to happen. If we allow our tongues to wag when the emotions are high. I'm telling you guys, it's never good. Never good. And there's not one couple in this room that can't relate to what it means to when the emotions are running high and you're angry. In fact, you shouldn't talk to your kids when you're feeling that way either. You shouldn't, you're gonna say dumb things, and you can kill a person's sense of worth by just beating them down like a dog with a rubber hose to the point where they can't get up again. And they'll go live the life that you've impressed upon them with your words. I heard a quote that really impacted me in my study of this, and that is that the words that we say to someone are going to live inside that person, maybe for a long time. And you know, when I thought about that, I thought, wow. First of all, that's a glorious gift that God has given us through speech, but what a powerful responsibility goes along with it. You know what I mean? To be sure that we're not going to cause something to live inside of someone that's just going to sit there and burn and fester. And you know, that's what words do. They burn long after they're spoken. I learned something. You know, I've been riding a motorcycle since I was in my teens, and I only had one time when I laid my bike down, and I did it in front of all the guys that I went biking with here from Calvary Chapel. We were over in Middleton, and I hit a curb, and bless his heart, Rob Sanders back there, who's a big boy, he picked me up right off my motorcycle. But I my bike went down this way, and my leg here laid against my muffler just for a few seconds. And I had long pants on, and my pants looked fine. They were like not singed. And I didn't realize even that I'd really been burned. I hopped back on my motorcycle and we drove home. And while I was driving home, though, my leg started to hurt. I was like, oh, okay, I must have. Well, what happened after a period of time, and I got home and looked at it, and it wasn't really all that bad. It was a little red. But in the next couple of days, it turned into this huge burn on my leg that was extremely painful. And I sat down with my laptop and I started Googling burns. I learned something. I learned that they keep burning after you get exposed to the heat source, and that you need to get it underwater or something like that to stop, because your cells sit and simmer. They literally sit and keep burning for days unless you put the fire out. Didn't know that. Wish I'd have known that. You know, I'd have been running for a bathtub, I suppose, or a body of water or something. Do you know the same thing is true with the words we speak? They just sit and keep burning. They just sit and keep sizzling and burning into a person's heart and into their mind and doing damage. And we have these things in the Word of God that tells us in the most colorful and animated language that it can possibly convey, it is a restless evil, this tongue that sits in our heads. And it is full of deadly poison, and we don't take it to heart and say, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to use my mouth that way. Look what he goes on in verse 9 to say. With our tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who've been made in God's likeness. We're here at church and we're going, oh, praise the Lord, and we're singing our songs, and you know, and all for you. You know, what a great lyric, right? And I'm just singing, all for you, Jesus, all for you, all for you. And I go home and I berate my children. Or I berate my wife. You know, James says, look what he says in verse 10. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. And he says, my brothers, this should not be. Did you notice he said, my brothers? You know who he's talking to? Christians. Brothers. Christians. These are people in the family of God. He says, this should not be. And he says, just by way of kind of, you know, example, can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? Even nature shows us these things don't go together. And he says, my brothers, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? No, neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. These are inconsistencies in nature, and God intended your mouth and my mouth to be used for him. There's only one problem. It's a big one, too. Sin came into the equation. You know, everything was great before sin came in. You know that, don't you? I mean, sin just messes with everything. And here we are, you know, God creates man, and he creates man with this beautiful instrument called the tongue. And it's powerful, and it's wonderful. And it's created by him to speak truth and speak praise and speak goodness and to build people up and to encourage and love on people and that sort of thing. And then sin comes in and pollutes and corrupts. And this thing now becomes a deadly poison. But you see, here's the deal. You and I have come to Jesus, I trust. And that means that our bodies, our lives, are now redeemed. And the word redeemed, you guys, is right out of the marketplace. The word redeemed means bought back. Okay? That means you and I have been purchased back. We were literally sold into sin and became slaves of sin, where we had no choice but to spew that kind of garbage. But now we've been redeemed, bought back, and the very mouth, the very tongue that you used to use for the ways of the world and for your own pleasures and so forth, now it belongs to God. It has been bought and paid for through the blood of Jesus Christ. Isn't that a delightful thought? And so now, through redemption, we have the opportunity to use our mouth once again to go back to God's original creative order and to begin to use our mouth for his purpose. Doesn't mean we're going to do it perfectly. That's where forgiveness comes into play. But we can do it. We can do it. We can use our mouths now to build people up, to encourage, to speak truth. You know, there's a lot of different ways that we can inappropriately use our mouth, and you know, it's already made reference to one of them already, and that's cursing. I talked about my own struggle with obscene language, you know, even after I met the Lord and started walking with him, and how it was just still so difficult for years. But then there's speaking slanderously, you know, behind someone's back, and we think, wow, speaking slanderously, I've never done that. Oh, it happens so easy. Hey, hi, Joe. How you doing there? Good. Okay. Well, all right. We'll see you on Thursday. Yep. Take care, buddy. All right. Goodbye. What an idiot. Right? That's slanderous. The guy is a jerk. Why do we say those things? We're using our mouths inappropriately. Complaining or grumbling. Do you know the Bible says we're to do everything without arguing or complaining? Some people have a higher propensity for complaining than others. Some people complain about everything. I think they all were raised in my home. I'm just kidding. My kids are good. They're good kids. Every parent probably thinks their kid complains more than all the others. Maybe I taught them how, huh? Lying is another dangerous and inappropriate use of the redeemed tongue that is now in our mouth. Gossip. The one thing we all universally believe is bad, but none of us think we ever do. Did you know that? We all think gossip is horrible, and none of us think we do it. I wasn't gossiping. I was just sharing that information so we could pray for her. You know. False accusations. You know, bearing false witness. Rudeness. Sometimes it's difficult, you know. It's difficult to just be kind. And we end up being rude instead. It's an inappropriate use of a redeemed tongue. Criticism. Very damaging. Very, very damaging. This is where the tongue that criticizes becomes the biggest troublemaker in the church, in the home, in the family. to criticize somebody is basically to kind of tear them down and highlight their faults. Do you know that God did not make you the police of other people to point out their issues and their problems? I've been doing marriage counseling, you know, for a lot of years now, and I really get tired of married couples who police each other. Yeah, but you! What's up with that? You know? Jesus would come to us and say, hey, deal with that log sticking out of your own eye before you start helping somebody else remove the speck in theirs. You know? In other words, tend to your own issues at home, right here at home in the heart. Deal with those issues. You know, I'll sit down with couples sometimes, or I'll sit down with one of the people from the couple, and all they want to do is talk about the other person. You ought to hear what my wife did this time. And you know what? I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear it. You know why? First of all, number one, she's not here to defend herself. Number two, it doesn't really matter. You and I can't do one single thing to change her. I just put it right back on him. So how about you? What have you done to participate in the downfall of this relationship? Even if your role wasn't that great in the downfall of the relationship, it still doesn't give you a right to police the other person. But yet we criticize. And then rejoicing in somebody else's misfortunes. Well, I'm glad that house burned to the ground. They deserved it. Whew. Boy, watch those words. They'll come back to bite you. One more quick scripture, and then we're going to close. Do not offer the parts, your Bible may say members of your body, to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer the parts of your body to Him as instruments of righteousness. You know, here's an instrument right here. An instrument right here and right here. And obviously, though, any instrument that's been created by man can be used for any purpose. I mean, somebody could get on these instruments and play the most vulgar, obscene music ever heard to man. You know what I mean? Or they can get on here and they can use this instrument to praise the Lord. The idea of what Paul is saying here in Romans is this is an instrument. This tongue in your mouth, this is an instrument. Use it for God. Use it to bring glory to God. Use it for righteousness. You are a redeemed person. You have been bought and paid for through the blood of the Lamb. Now let's use the instrument God has given us to bring glory to Him. Amen? Let's stand together and let's pray about that just for a moment. I'm going to give everybody, myself included, just a moment of silence so that we can just take whatever area of conviction that the Lord has presented to us, and I trust that He has been faithful to do that, and just offer it up to Him. First of all, to confess, yeah, Lord, you spoke to me here today, and that's an area of my life that I need to change, and I ask you to forgive me. I receive your forgiveness, your cleansing, and now I ask for your power to give me the strength to have victory over that area of my life.